you all, we're going to begin by seeing number 331. Who is he born in the stall? The children know this really well, so they're all going to help us sing. Thank you.
morning and a warm welcome to all on this Lord's Day, a day that we particularly remember the birth of our Lord and Savior. It is indeed good to worship the Lord with his people on this day. One announcement, a prayer request this morning, both a prayer request and also a thanksgiving for God's faithfulness on behalf of Nelson and Leanne Canis. They drove to Alberta, and when they arrived on Friday morning, little Molly was looking very lethargic and unresponsive, and they took her to the hospital, and then from the Barrhead Hospital, they immediately took her to the Stollery Children's Hospital in Edmonton, and they found that she had influenza A and septic shock, but she is doing much better today, and they anticipate hopefully being released from the hospital today. So, very, very scary, but also thankfulness that they were able to go to the hospital, to get help, and that the Lord was indeed faithful. So continue to pray for them, as well as to thank God for his faithfulness. Our call to worship comes from Psalm 98. O sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made known his salvation. He has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Let us come before the Lord in a moment of silent prayer. Please rise. Congregation of the Lord, our help is the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Amen. Now lift up your hearts and receive the Lord's greeting. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As an opening song of praise, we'll sing from number 312. Christians awake, salute the happy morn. Number 312.
Thank you.
Once more this morning, we turn to the law of the Lord, found in Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. When our Lord Jesus Christ was asked, Teacher, what is the greatest commandment? He said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Once again, as we hear these words, week by week, we're reminded that we have not loved God as we ought, that we have not loved neighbors we're called to love, and we're reminded again and again of our need for the one who has, the one whose birth we celebrate today. So we're pointed in our song of confession then to our Lord and Savior. And so as a song of confession, we'll sing number 320, As With Gladness Men of Old, number 320.
Thank you.
confess our sins. He is faithful to forgive our sins because of the blood of Christ. So this morning, our assurance of pardon comes from John chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, or 16 through 18, rather. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. Praise God for that. The good news of the gospel, that love of God that we celebrate each and every Lord's Day. Let us come before the Lord in prayer. Merciful Father, you so loved the world that you gave your only begotten Son for us. He who was rich became poor for us, the eternal Word made flesh, a great light shining in the darkness. Only because of your Word and Spirit have we seen that light and been drawn into its brightness. Give us the grace humbly and joyfully to receive your Son, even as the shepherds and princes who welcomed him, and to look no further for our redemption than to this child lying in a manger, to our Lord and Savior. Father, we pray for your church in this day, and for your church in Talqua. Oh Lord, you know the cares that often weigh heavy on our hearts. You know our every need. And we pray for safety for those traveling at this time to spend time with family and friends. And in these times of fellowship, may you be praised. May your name be exalted. Father, we pray for those who mourn at this time of year especially. For those for whom this is a painful reminder of those who've gone before, bless us with comfort as we look to you. Lord, we pray for the sick among us. Strengthen us, O Lord. Be with those who struggle with colds and flus that so many have at this time of year. Be with those who are waiting for surgery or waiting for further testing. Give patience as we wait on your timing. And Father, we pray for little Molly Canis. And we thank you for your faithfulness shown to her and her family in this last week. And Father, we thank you for the positive news that she may be released today. And Father, we pray for continued healing, for continued strength for Molly and for her family as well. Lord, we thank you for your care. We thank you for the successful surgery for our brother Leo in this past week as well, for that answer to prayer for him, that his knee could be replaced. Father, be with our brother as he rests and recuperates from the surgery. And Father, we pray for all those among us who struggle with health. We think of those who struggle with their eyesight. We pray that they would continue to clearly see your faithfulness and love. And we pray for those for whom the advance of age is so readily apparent as our bodies break down ever more quickly. And we pray for those for whom it is not easy to get out anymore. We pray that you would comfort the lonely, that you would encourage us and encourage us to be a blessing to one another. And we pray for those whose struggles go unseen by many, for the discouraged, the anxious, the depressed. Lord, you know how much we need your strength day by day. And bless us by your Word and Spirit in this day. Encourage us as we open your word, as we look to you. O Lord, open our hearts and minds to hear your word. We would go away changed, blessing you for your faithfulness. All this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Luke chapter 2. The last 3 weeks we've been looking at some of those songs of praise in the Gospel of Luke. The song of Mary, the song of Zechariah, the song of the angels. And now we come to the song of Simeon in Luke chapter 2. It's often called the Nunc Dimittis, from the Latin, which begins this blessing in the Latin. Now you dismiss. Now you dismiss. So we'll read from chapter 2, the first 7 verses, and then picking up again in verse 22, and our text will be verses 25 through 35. So we'll read of the birth of Jesus, and then we'll skip ahead to Jesus presented at the temple. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee to the town of, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And then verse 22. And when the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem, to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or 2 young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And when he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. And his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, Behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed, and a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. And there was a prophetess Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years, having lived with her husband 7 years from when she was a virgin, and then as a widow until she was 84. She did not depart from the temple, worshiping with fasting and prayer night and day. And coming up at that very hour, she began to give thanks to God and to speak of him to all who were waiting for the redemption of Jerusalem. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. As a song of preparation, we'll sing from number 299, Joy to the World. Standing to sing number 299. Brothers and sisters in the Lord, are you prepared for death? Will it be a day of regrets, a day of wishing that you'd done things differently, a day of clinging to life as long as possible? Are you prepared for death? Perhaps it seems a little bit strange to even ask that question at Christmas. And Christmas is a day of joy, of celebration, of new life, the day that we celebrate the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But no amount of presents, of festive cheer and fellowship on this day could paper over the whole. The void, if you can't answer that question, are you prepared for death? It's an unexpected question, perhaps, on this morning, but it's only in what Jesus came to earth to do, that work begun on that day 2,000 years ago, that life that will lead all the way to the cross, the resurrection of our Lord and his ascension. It's only in what Jesus came to do that you can say with Simeon, Lord, you are letting your servant depart in peace. It's only in what Jesus came to do that you can have comfort in life and in death. We looked this morning at the birth of the Prince of Peace and the peace that he brings. So first of all, as we look at that peace, you see a servant dismissed. Simeon. We don't know a great deal about Simeon. His Christmas letter that he sends out to family and friends, we'd say we know very little of the important things about Simeon. What did Simeon do? Well, many say he was maybe a priest, but we don't know that. How old was he? We generally assume that Simeon was a very old man, but we actually don't know that either. Was he married? We don't know. Did he have children? We don't know. There's a great deal of things that we don't know about him. We might say we know very little of the important things, things that you could fill that Christmas letter to family and friends with about Simeon. But at the same time, we know everything of importance about Simeon. He's a righteous man. He's a devout man. He's a waiting man. He's waiting on the promises of God. What we know about Simeon is that he's a believer. He's waiting on the promises of God. And he's waiting on a very particular promise, because there were those in Israel who were waiting for that consolation of Israel, waiting for that Messiah to come. There were still those who were longing for that Messiah. But Simeon had a very particular promise. The Lord has revealed to him, you will see the consolation of Israel. You will see the Messiah. And so Simeon, we might say, is a watchman, like a servant who's been assigned to watch on the city walls, watching for the rise of the morning sun. That servant can't go to bed when he feels a little bit sleepy. He can't go and do things with his friends when they're off enjoying themselves. He's called to watch, to wait. To wait on the promises of God is what Simeon is called to do, to watch and to wait. He's a believer. Believers are called to watch, to wait. But now Simeon comes to the temple. And he takes this child in his arms and he makes a remarkable statement. He says, Lord. And this isn't the usual word for Lord. This is the word that we'd get the word despot from in English. The word Lord, that means absolute authority, absolute power, sovereignty, might. He says, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. Depart, dismiss. It's the word that's used for a watchman whose watch is ended. He's dismissed. It's the word that's used when a military camp is packed up. Their watch and wait is over. They're dismissed. Their watch is over. What Simeon is not saying is, oh, I've spent my whole life watching, waiting. I missed out on doing all the things that my friends were doing. I'm glad that's done, and now I can go and have a retirement on the seaside, move into my little condo on the Mediterranean. I don't have to keep watching day after day. No, what Simeon is saying here is, I'm ready to die now. I'm ready to die, Lord. I'm ready to die in peace. I've seen everything that I need to see. There's nothing else I want to see here. He's speaking as one for whom the grave has lost its terror and the world has lost its charm. I'm ready to die. Can you say the same? We often have that picture in our mind of Simeon as this old man who's been waiting and waiting and waiting. But we don't actually know that. But often we think of Simeon as an old man because, well, in part, often we think of death as something that is for the old. That maybe once we've achieved a good old age, we'll be ready to die in peace too. And Simeon, we assume, has achieved a very good old age. But whether he's old or young doesn't actually matter here. Because whether old or young, death comes to all. To some, at a ripe old age, after a lifetime of seeing their family and friends, and to some, at a very young age, death comes to all. But are you prepared to die? Anyone who's seen Jesus with the eyes of faith, who's received Jesus as Lord, whether young or old, the age doesn't matter. Anyone who's seen Jesus is prepared to die. And if you haven't seen Jesus with the eyes of faith, young or old, it doesn't matter. If you haven't seen Jesus, if you have not trusted in Jesus, then you are not prepared to die in peace. Simeon rejoices, I've seen the Christ. I'm ready to go now. I've seen all I need to see. Can you say the same? But why? Why can Simeon, after one glimpse of this child? We've got this child brought to the temple. His parents don't look like much. The child probably doesn't look that unordinary. They're bringing the offering that poor people bring. Simeon says, I'm ready to depart, for my eyes have seen. The reason is my eyes have seen your salvation that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples. He's seen salvation because he's seen Jesus. Salvation isn't something that can be wrapped up in a box by Jesus and put under the Christmas tree for you to come and to receive it and apart from Jesus. Simeon hasn't seen Jesus' life, his perfect life in our place. He hasn't seen his death, that cruel death on the cross. He hasn't seen the resurrection. All of those things matter. All of those things are important. He's only seen the beginning of the picture. But he's seen the one who is salvation. So that he can say, my eyes have seen your salvation because I've seen the one who is the salvation and the life. I've seen the one who is the salvation. The salvation of all the world. That salvation isn't apart from Christ. It's only in Christ. He's seen the salvation of the world. He's got good news for the whole world, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples a light for revelation to the Gentiles, for glory to your people, Israel. This is good news for the world that he celebrates. This is good news for the world that we celebrate today. It's good news for the world. This is the reason that some of our families aren't here today, because they're in Africa. This is the reason that some of our families aren't here today, because they're in seminary. Because that gospel is for the ends of the world. And that's the reason that you and I are called to shine that light where we are as well. Family, friends, acquaintances, because that good news is for the world. The light in a world of darkness. The world is covered in darkness because of sin. But Jesus comes to scatter that darkness, to shine the light of salvation, to shine his light. I am the light of the world, he says, the dark corners of human hearts. The light of the world in a world of darkness. Sometimes we see the darkness and get discouraged. We look around and say, things are really bad now. The world is really dark now. The world opposes things like valuing biblical sexuality. Marriage between a man and a woman for life is mocked today. It's outdated. Life is devalued today, all the way from from the beginning of life, the abortion of the unborn, all the way to the end of life, and euthanasia, and everywhere in between, in a culture of death. There's rumors of wars, there's abuse, ethics are mocked. We sometimes see this and say things look really dark. And you feel a little bit hopeless, longing for the good old days. The light comes in the darkness. If anything, we could say it was even darker in the time of Jesus. Sexual immorality, violence, abuse, there was horrific darkness. There was blindness in a world given over to sin. John Calvin, so this is in the 1500s, the Reformation, a day when people are being martyred for their faith, when people are being burned at the stake. John Calvin looks back at the darkness and the time around the birth of Jesus and says, they experienced persecution so cruel that today's burnings, by comparison, nothing. This is in a day when the world is in Calvin's day, the world is in darkness. And the very ones who are called to hold that light up, the church, the Roman church, is contributing to keeping people in the darkness. And people are being martyred, and he says, this isn't so bad. It was even darker back then. And it was in that world, in the first century, in the very shadow of the pagan temples, of idolatry and all forms of immorality, in the very heart of the darkness of idolatry and paganism, and abuse of all kinds, that light shines in the darkness. That light shines. A light for revelation. The light of Christ dispels the darkness in the hearts of those bound by idolatry and death. Is that light any less powerful today? A light for revelation to the Gentiles. Good news, gospel news, in a world of darkness. Good news, gospel news today in a world of much darkness. This is also the glory of Israel. Many in Jesus' day looked for a day of glory. There's promises for the glory of Israel. They're looking forward to this day when we're going to be on top. We've been crushed and despised and trodden on, and we're going to be on top one day. There's promises. Isaiah 60 speaks of the glory of Israel. Isaiah 60, verse 1, arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples, but the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will be seen upon you. And nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. And at times, Israel wanted that glory to be to glorify them, just like we sometimes want a little bit of glory ourselves. But as Simeon looks at the child, at Jesus Christ, he says, this is the glory to your people Israel. This is that the one. It doesn't look glorious, humble, despised, but it's in this child, this son of David, born of Mary, that Simeon can look and say, this is that promised glory. The glory of Israel is that through them, through the Son of David, the promised Messiah has come to bring light to the world. That's the glory to Israel, that this Son has come to bring light in a dark world. Salvation displayed in the song of Simeon, in that blessing. In some ways, it'd be comfortable if the song ended there. It's good news. It's joyful news. Merry Christmas to all, and to all a good night. It's joyful, comfortable. Maybe allows life to go on unchanged. But then he gives a further prophecy. In the shadow of the cross, falls across these pages as well. Simeon draws the blade that will pierce Mary's soul. Because how does this salvation come about? Not just in the birth of this baby, not just in the child in a manger, because he doesn't stay in the manger. And so Mary, his mother, will see him grow, will see him teaching his miracles. She'll see him despised and rejected. And she'll see the gory death on the cross, the sword that pierces her soul as she sees her sinless son die. Because that good news, that joy, that salvation, that light comes only through the death of Jesus. Because sin deserves death. And here is where the world either rises with Christ, where you either rise with Christ or fall. This child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed. We see the sign opposed here. Sometimes when we think of a sign, we think of a little road sign. And those little road signs are often hard to see. You're driving at night, especially in a dark winter night, and the snow's blowing, and you've got this little sign, and you blink and you miss it. You could miss it so easily. And sometimes we wonder, is Jesus like that sign? We have the sign opposed here. Am I left to wonder, was that the one? Did I miss the sign? And Jesus is a sign opposed, but that word for sign doesn't allow this sign to be hidden. It's a word that means manifested, out in the open, that which is seen, so visible, so clear that no one can miss it. There's no missing the sign here. There's opposing the sign or receiving the sign. Opposing the sign or receiving the sign. Because this is where that passage, that prophecy becomes hard. What do you make of the Christ? He will either be the stone of stumbling, Isaiah chapter 8, verses 14, over which you stumble and fall, opposing him, the sign opposed, or he will be the sure cornerstone, Isaiah 28, verse 16, that the cornerstone that will not disappoint, the cornerstone of your life. Because what do you make of Jesus? Either you trust in him alone, recognizing that my sins deserve death. But I look to Jesus alone for life. I trust in him alone. My life is built on his foundation, in which case you rise with Christ. He is your hope of life, of resurrection. Or you reject him, or you oppose him. You say, my sins aren't that bad. I'm a fairly good person. I'll find my way. I will not have this man as my Lord and Savior. In which case, he is a sign opposed, the rock on which you will shatter, and appointed for the fall of many, a fall that is death. Not just physical death, but spiritual death. Because this passage, this prophecy, highlights to us that there is no neutrality. You're either with Jesus or you're opposed to Jesus. There's nothing else. You're either with Jesus, trusting in Jesus, resting in him alone, or you're opposed. And Jesus comes to reveal the thoughts of many hearts. Do you trust in him or in something else? And Jesus comes as the Prince of Peace. We celebrate that. We sing that. Peace on earth, goodwill to man. But that peace is only found in him. The question that we face, not just at Christmas, each and every day, is what do you make of the Christ? Do you oppose him? Falling? Or do you receive him, rising with him and that hope of resurrection and life, in which case you are ready to die in peace? Are you ready to die in peace because you've seen the Prince of Peace? Each and every year we have reminders again and again that death is approaching. We have reminders of the frailty of our bodies. We have reminders of those who've gone before. We know, even as we don't know the day of our death, each year is a reminder that it's 1 year closer. Is that day a day of fear, of uncertainty, of terror? Or can we say, because we have seen Jesus with the eyes of faith, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation. Because it's only in the Prince of Peace that you can have peace that endures in life and in death. Amen. Let us pray. Merciful God and Heavenly Father, we thank you for the good news that we celebrate in this day, that in the birth of Jesus and what he has done in his life and death and resurrection, that we can say with Simeon, we're ready to depart in peace. Lord, give us that comfort as we look to Jesus alone, as we trust in him alone. And give us that comfort, that peace that endures in life and in death, that this day would indeed be a joyful day of celebration of what you've done. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll stand and sing from number 295. The Song of Simeon, number 295. At this time, the deacons will take up the offering, and the offering is for the work of the diaconate. We'll stand and sing as a song of praise, number 315, Silent Night, Holy Night. Blessing. Our doxology is number 313, Angels from the Realms of Glory. Lift up your hearts and receive the Lord's parting blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.